Good evening and welcome to the Joy of Living speaker meeting. My name is Marcella, I'm an alcoholic, and we're going to start this meeting with a moment of silence followed by the preamble. Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We're also supporting through our own contributions. AA is not aligned with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution, does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. Well, welcome tonight to our very first speakers meeting. This meeting is being recorded and will be available in our own YouTube channel in a few hours. And our very first speaker is going to be Jay, and he's going to speak for half an hour. And then we'll have 3 minute shares.
Is it my turn to speak?
Yep.
Very good. Hello, everybody. My name is Jay. I'm a grateful alcoholic. I've been sober since May the 2nd of 2015. Through the grace of God and a sponsor guiding me through the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, that sponsor still continues to guide me today. I asked him whether it would be a good idea to invite the woman I'm dating for 4 months to listen to me share. And within, he cut me off and he goes, no. And so even to this day, I still need guidance in order to get feedback on what I consider to be good ideas. So I got sober May the 2nd. And what happened on May the 1st of 2015 is I had moved to Austin, Texas. It was 1 year after I graduated from college, and I was meeting with a drinking friend from high school. And we drank all day to the point where I was throwing up pure liquid alcohol into a trash bag at 3 o'clock in the morning. And the next day I went to go check an apartment so that I could lease it. And I started a new job with the worst hangover of my life up to that point. The good news is I got the apartment. The bad news is I lost the job 5 days later. And I was furiously pissed off because that was the last good idea that I had after college. So I went to Al-Anon. And I went to Al-Anon for a day and it didn't resonate with me. So the next day I went to AA. And what was amazing about that experience, my very first meeting in Austin, Texas, it was this eclectic group of people, old, young men, women, different backgrounds that were sharing their story that sounded like my story. And I was 23, turning 24 in 18 days at the time. And where my drinking career ended, because I'd only been drinking for 10 years at that time, their stories continued. They had worse consequences that included jail, institutions, some deaths. And then they found AA. And then they started living what sounded like a wonderful but simple life that sounded impossible to me. I used to think anybody who worked a 9-to-5 was a sheep, and anybody who believed in religion was brainwashed, and that I was the only honest, real thinker among the entire human race. And I was pioneering the millennial revolution. So when I heard these fellow people sharing what sounded like my story and identifying as alcoholics, I was relieved. I got to tell you, I was relieved. And I'll tell you why, and I'll tell it from this perspective. So fast forward 3 years where I'm not practicing the program, but I'm also not drinking. And I find a sponsor who starts demonstrating to me that even though I'm not drinking, it's not that great of an accomplishment because I don't know anything about the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous or the 12 Steps and 12 Traditions book of Alcoholics Anonymous. And if I'm supposed to be a practitioner of any employment, any profession, it's really important that I know what it is I'm doing. If I'm studying any subject, to be able to know what the textbook says and how to practice what's in the textbook is a basic requirement. And my sponsor, my future sponsor, was pointing out to me that I didn't know anything. And so the reason I'm bringing it up this way is what happened on step one with him is he had me go back in my past and look at the examples of powerlessness over alcohol and over life I had throughout my life. And I could see back when I was about 5 years old, I think my parents let me drink champagne because it was New Year's or something, and I had like a sip and I didn't like it. And I had like a glass of wine when we traveled to Europe when I was like 9 or 10. And those were my first experiences drinking, and I didn't really like it. But the first time I really drank alcohol, I was about 13 or 14 years old, and I was hanging out with my older sister and her friends, and they had a Slurpee that was just completely filled with vodka. It was the best tasting drink I had ever had in my whole life, and probably it was supposed to be shared. I drank the whole thing myself. And the way I know I blacked out that night is because I woke up on the second floor of our house in my bed, not knowing how I climbed the stairs and went from the pool to my room. And the best part about that night is the next morning, my sister has a book of quotes of what I said that she found hilarious. And she had written down these things that I did that were amazing. In other words, I became a legend my first night of drinking alcohol. And I spent the next 10 years of my life trying to find the concoction of alcohol and drugs that would allow me to relive that moment. I never got it right. I mean, I tried and I tried and I tried. It's not like I was writing it down in a book. That might have been a more scientific approach. I kind of just played Wheel of Fortune every night, and I didn't realize half of the wheel was bankrupt. And maybe the best thing that I could do on a given night was just feel comfortable and okay in my own skin. You know, that was the game that I was playing. It was not a good game, but I didn't know there were other games that could be played. I was certainly seeking an answer. I spent a lot of time researching religion. So I get to college. I had been brought up sort of atheist. I didn't have any formal religious upbringing. And when I got to college, I stumbled upon Christianity. And I was looking into the Bible, and it was the first encounter I really had with this idea of God. And it was an enamoring idea. I mean, I was a philosophy major when I first got to college. So you can imagine a philosopher like realizing about God. I mean, that's what it was like for me. Oh, there could be God. Okay. And I started exploring Christianity, and I started exploring Judaism, and I started exploring Hinduism and Buddhism and learning about religion and learning about anthropology. And each one of those had its own significance for me where I was at in my development. But sticking to the alcoholism, when I was in college, my alcoholism really took off because I joined a fraternity. And the joke in the fraternity is you're not an alcoholic if you're in a fraternity. And I certainly didn't think that I was an alcoholic because I would stop drinking on Saturday night. You know, I had friends that would wake up on Sunday and keep drinking. And so I thought I'm not doing so bad. And I had friends that would purposefully suffer during the week because of the ability to build up this excuse to drink and to party. And when I got out of college, alcohol became the crutch that allowed me to get through what seemed like a miserable existence. Now I was on my own. I had spent 16 years in private education. And within 1 year, I got into AA, like I was sharing. So during that time, while I was going downhill rather quickly, I did not half-ass my self-destruction emotionally. On paper, I still looked great. But I lost several jobs. I burned almost every bridge I had with people from high school and college in that 1 year. Really, I was living in a national park at one point, and the only people I was talking to were my parents because of how afraid they were of what it would be like if I just fell off the grid. And I don't blame them. But that was one of the things I realized later was the way I was harming people unintentionally in my life, and something that I ended up making amends for down the line. So the short version of what I saw in step one when I was working that with my sponsor is I have a lot of examples in my life that demonstrate I'm an alcoholic. Now, I never got arrested. I never got a DUI. I never went to a treatment center. I never killed anybody. I never even got into an accident or hit anything with my car when I was drunk. But it's what was going on inside of me and the excuse that I utilized alcohol to cure the problem. You know, it says in the doctor's opinion, alcoholics drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol. And the effect that was produced by alcohol for me was this elusive sensation that everything was okay. You know, it was just like a deep breath, like, huh, now I can just hang out and my mind is no longer driving me bananas. And what my sponsor was able to demonstrate to me on step one was that my life was pretty abnormal. I thought my life was pretty normal. It was pretty abnormal. And like it says in the doctor's opinion, I could not differentiate the true from the false. That's who I was when I came into AA, even 3 years after not drinking. Without practicing the program, it makes no difference how long I stop drinking for. What matters to me is whether I'm able to practice the principles of the program. And so in step two, my sponsor had me do a quite different exercise. And he had me start writing out specific sentences about what I would like my God to be. Now, this is my story, my version of God. I hated God. I was a depressed high schooler student. When I was driving to therapy for my depression, a bug smashed up against my windshield and I witnessed it dying. And I wept. I was crying because I go, God, you have put me on this earth and all I can do is destroy. And I don't even want to be alive. That is such a sick and twisted sense of humor. And I couldn't kill myself because I couldn't allow the guilt and the shame of what that would mean for my parents and for my family, where they might think they had something to do with it. So I was stuck in this middle ground where I had to be alive. You know, I'm like, oh, I'm forced to be alive and just like endure the misery on my own. It was a nightmare. My prayers became, God, please kill me in a fatal car crash so that I'll be dead and that nobody will have to bear the burden of me killing myself. And that was God for me for a long time. And then when I got to college and I discovered Christianity, God became a lot more intense. You know, God was a more regular part of my day. But it was like Santa Claus keeping the naughty list. I never got on the nice list with my version of God. I was always being punished. God was always looking at me and seeing what I was doing wrong. And I always had to figure out how to get away with stuff. When I was in college, my intelligence was not, how can I actually learn and be a good student? It was, how can I get the best grades while putting in the least amount of effort possible? And that's what it was in my relationships with people also. How can you think that I'm a saint while I'm a criminal and I'm lying to your face? That was my whole measure of intelligence. The wider the gap between who you think I am as a good person and who I actually am as a bad person, the smarter I must be. I didn't know that's what was going on at the time, but luckily the program has demonstrated that to me. So on step two, I was able to get past my fear of God. And the way that occurred for me is my sponsor defined what understanding is. And it comes from the Greek language and it means to stand safely under the tree. So when I was writing down these short and specific sentences, the way I knew that I had completed step two, and I think the way my sponsor knew I completed step two, is I had arrived at a conception of God. I didn't get all the way. I didn't arrive at the beauty of infinity and unity with the world, but I got close enough with myself that I felt safe and secure and that I was no longer being hunted by God for all the bad things I did in my life. And what was the most important revelation for me was the idea of grace at this part in the program. And the definition of grace is that it's a free gift. It's not something I earn. It's not necessarily something I deserve, but it's something that I have been given by God, which is why I say I am a grateful alcoholic, sober since May the 2nd, by the grace of God, by the free gift of God. Because if there were a way to earn God's grace, my track record would not have been the way to have earned God's grace. So that's how I know it's a free gift. And so then I moved on to step three. And what happened on step three is my sponsor helped me to see an alcoholic is somebody who does two things at one time and almost does both of them well. Well, I was doing seven things at the same time and I was doing none of them well. I had my full-time job. I had the program. I was trying to become nationally competitive in chess again. I was studying to get my master's in business. I had a second job on the clock of my first job because I thought my employer wasn't paying me enough. And when I had done the math later with my sponsor, I thought they were paying me a certain number. I was just looking at my salary after they had deducted from taxes, and I wasn't including like bonuses and benefits. So I was just so far out of reality, making myself ungrateful for the wonderful opportunity I had been given due to bad math, just bad math. No facts involved at all. I'm able to run my life without any facts involved at all. Like, that's how I can make a problem out of any solution. That's how I know I'm a real alcoholic, you know? Something doesn't have to even itch for me to want to scratch it. That's how bad it can get for me with untreated alcoholism. So I'm on step three, and my sponsor is displaying for me the insanity of my life. And he asked me what I want to do about it, because my sponsor never told me what to do. He would ask me questions and help me to see what was going on so that we could look at it together and arrive at a conclusion that was corroborated by the big book in the 12 and 12. And I remember it was a Monday, we were having this conversation, and I had plans for each of these individual components of my life that were distracting me. I said, well, I hear what you're saying. Here's what I'm going to do. On Thursday, I'm going to let the public speaking group I'm a part of, that I'm a treasurer of, let them know I'm having second thoughts about being treasurer. And for the master's program, I'm going to let them know I'm like reevaluating my schedule. And then next week I will drop the bomb so they can be, you know, it can cushion the blow. And my sponsor goes, well, does your phone not work between today and Thursday? It only works Mondays and Thursdays. I was like, no, all right, I see what you're saying. And I practiced willingness, which is a key component of step three. And how it's defined for me in step three is willingness is the readiness to do something at the earliest possible moment, not when it's convenient, not when I would like to. And so I practice willingness by, within the next 2 hours, eliminating everything from my life besides my full-time job in the program. And that was what was essential for me to be able to continue with the program. So now I'm on step four, and it was quite a shock for me because I'm on step four and my sponsor has me starting to write out on a notepad how to do step four. And I have this notepad. I know it's going to be on audio, but y'all have the video, so you get the advantage. So the notepad has these pink margins and it goes across. He had me number the columns 1, 2, 3, and 4. And I did column 1 on this side of this pink margin, column 2 over here where it was like the cause. Column 3 was what it affects on this side of the pink margin, the smaller side. And then my part was on the larger side of this margin. What was amazing about my step four is my sponsor had me do it column by column, not row by row. Because if I'm doing it column by column, I don't have to change my mind. You know, I was a salesperson for a company called, or just for a marketing company. And one of the actions they had me do, because they were kind of a pyramid scheme, but what they wanted me to do was write down every person I could possibly think of that I would want to market this product to. And so for 30 minutes, I sat down and just wrote names. That was the exercise. You just write names and they'd be like, who are your relatives? Who are your friends? Who are their friends? Who are their parents? You write names. So that's what I did. Column 1, names. Column 2, what was the cause? Column 3, what did it affect? And column 4, what was my part? Once I had written all that down and I called up my sponsor and I said, I think I got it all. He said, keep going. And so I had more stuff. I didn't know I had more stuff. Eventually I got done and it was a Wednesday and I called my sponsor and he says, okay, not this Saturday, but next Saturday, you're going to come over to my house and we're going to do step 5. So my step 4 experience took 9 days in total and it was right after step 3. So that's how long, you know, give or take, it probably needs to take. And if I'm practicing willingness and just being calm and objective about it. But by the way, the first time I got to step 4 with my same sponsor, I started getting all emotionally messed up. I was getting depressed. I was in self-pity. And then my sponsor explained to me pretty calmly. He said, do you know what the opposite of anger is? I said, I have no idea what the opposite of anger is. And he said, it's self-pity. And I used to think I was so spiritually enlightened because other people around me were getting angry and were expressing their emotions on the outside. And I was able to bottle mine up. So I felt very like elevated, you know, like, look at me, I'm calm and I'm detached. When he expressed to me that self-pity was anger in reverse, I was able to see I was in the same boat as everybody else. I just hit it better. Made me no better, made me no different. I just was focusing it in a different direction. So I'm on step five. I go over to his house and we speak for about 5 hours. And the beautiful thing is he's able to demonstrate to me what I'm not able to see for myself. I had wrote all this stuff out and thought I knew what it meant. When I shared it with him, he demonstrated point by point what the common denominators of my life were. What were the defects of character that represented the underlying behavioral patterns of how I mess up my relationships with women, of how I mess up my relationships with friends, of how I mess up being an employee and get fired from jobs. And it really wasn't that mysterious. I mean, the reason my ex-girlfriends didn't like me is I cheated on them. I thought it made me a better boyfriend. If I'm not dependent on you for sex, you can't tell me what to do. And if you can't tell me what to do, I can stand up to you and that makes me a better boyfriend. I mean, that was my kind of brilliant thinking. You know, the reason my friends didn't like me is because I would steal things from them. And then when they found out it was missing, I would help them look for it. I thought I was enhancing their security protocols. I mean, you got to know what's going on in your life. So here's a way that I'm able to twist a bad intention and through justification and rationalization, make it something honorable and noble. When just on the surface, if anybody were to look at it plainly with an inch of reality, they could see it was criminal. It's not just not okay, it's criminal. If I'm looking at my own step four, that's what I see, is the rosy unicorns and rainbows. That one wasn't so bad. Oh, that person deserved it. But when I do my step five with my sponsor, I'm able to get somebody else who's providing me clear and direct feedback and guidance and not pulling any punches, which is what I needed. So, okay, I'm in step five. I'm now in step six, where I have these common denominators, these defects of character. And it's a beautiful thing, having what is no longer this ambiguous, unbearable load on my shoulders where I just feel like I'm a messed up person who's irreparable because I don't even know what's wrong. I'm like the guy taking his car to his mechanic and just saying, it's making a weird noise, please help. That was me. But then I took it to my sponsor and he said, your engine light is on, your tail light's broken, you need different spark plugs. Here's the remedy for you in particular. I now knew with specificity what my defects of character were. And that's fantastic because on step seven, what happened was he had me write out on the left side of a piece of paper each one of the defects of character. And then on the right side of the piece of paper, I wrote out its corresponding practice with the program. So as long as I'm substituting the practice of the program in step seven with whatever my defect of character was in step six, I no longer have that defect of character. Ta-da! You know, it says in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, we of Alcoholics Anonymous are 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. To show the reader precisely how we have recovered is the purpose of this book. So I am a recovered alcoholic because I no longer drink alcohol and I am no longer obsessed with the idea of drinking alcohol. Now, if I were to go back and start drinking again, I would be an active alcoholic again. But for the moment, that's not one of my defects of character. I haven't lied in a while. I haven't stolen anything in a while. So I'm no longer a thief. That's fantastic. That's no longer one of my defects of character until I decide to pick something up from a bar stool the next day. My sponsor taught me all of this. This is not something that I knew coming into the program. So, okay, I'm on step eight and step nine, and I'm having a problem because now I know what's wrong with me, but I think it's somebody else's fault. I think it's somebody else's fault. You know, I got all this stuff going on with me. It's my parents' fault for making me this way. It's God's fault for making me this way. If you had my life, you would be this way too. Well, actually, it turns out if you had my life, you probably would be a pretty grateful human being. Because what my sponsor helped me to do in steps eight and nine is he helped me to look at reality and look at the facts. And most importantly, with my parents, he was able to help me do an exercise where on one side of a sheet of paper, I wrote down all the things I had done for my parents and all the things that they had done for me. And that for me was the easiest one. I'm like, they win, it's no comparison. But then he had me flip the paper over. And then he had me compare what my parents had done against me to what I had done against my parents. And this was the biggest shocker for me, because what I began to see were that the facts of my life were that my parents were phenomenal people, and that I was the one that needed to come to the table and ask for forgiveness. Now, I know that's not everybody's story, and I'm not saying that's the way it needs to be for you with your parents and your story. I'm just telling you the way that it was for me and what the facts were for my life. And it was a tremendous revelation, partially because my dad was my boss at the time. So, you know, it helps when you like the person you're working for. I also had two older sisters. I made amends to them. I went to my ex-girlfriends, and in certain instances, I couldn't get a hold of them, so I didn't reach out to them. In other instances, I was a kid when I did my wrong, so it wasn't important to reach out to them. But to the extent that I did wrong against women, my sponsor had me donate a certain amount of money to a shelter that is for abused women. And to the extent that I had decided to abuse the cat that was in our household growing up, my sponsor had me donate to the ASPCA. So there are certain things that I can't do directly, but there are many things that I can do that are a sufficient amend in order to be able to live rightly. And I went to all these people and I made my amends. And the way that I did it was I didn't say, hey, I'm really sorry that I did this to you. Now let's move on. What I did was I went to these people with an entirely different perspective on my life. My sponsor demonstrated to me that I had done wrong. And I was actually able to see beyond my rosy glasses that I had done things I would no longer like to do. They no longer represent the character of the man that I choose to be today. And that was a really important shift for me, because then when I went to these people, I could say, I wronged you. I'm really sorry. It was not okay what I did to you. And by the way, here are the specific things that I see that I did to you that I don't like that I did. And then I would ask them, I would say, here are all the things that I saw. Was there anything that I missed? Do you have anything that you would like to bring up to me that I, how I wronged you? And then I would give them space. I wouldn't defend any of my actions. I would let them talk. And I wouldn't try to say, well, what had happened there was, or try to explain it. I would listen. And when all of that was over, we would have on the table everything that had gone wrong between us in the past. And I would say, okay, here's what had gone wrong. What can I do to make it right? And that to me is what the amend is. What can I do to make it right? And then they would tell me, and I would do my absolute best to follow through on what it is they asked me to do, to the best of my ability, to the best that it was a reasonable request. And it was a wonderful experience. I have to tell you, being able to look at people in the eye with an entirely new consciousness, where I'm saying I can see that what I did was wrong and have people forgive me. What I learned is that amends are for me, they're not for the other person. And thank God for that, because there were some people who reacted negatively to my amends. And it was important for me to know that the amend is for me. It is not for the other person to have the relief. And the other important thing was my sponsor, he had me refer back to my idea about God in step two. And one of the things I had written about God was that God was a forgiving God. And my sponsor said, okay, well, if God has forgiven all of these people, how come you're not forgiving them? That must mean you're playing God. You must disagree with God's forgiveness. And I went, oh, you tricked me. Like, that was a trap. But it was what I needed to hear, and it was true. God had already forgiven me, which is how I could come to understand grace. And therefore, God had already forgiven these other people. And I was able to demonstrate my grace toward them by demonstrating God's grace in their lives as well as in my own. And where I'm at today, because steps 10, 11, and 12, there's really what I can say about them is in how I practice them in my life today and how they resemble a spiritual fitness program for me on a daily basis. So today, a typical day looks like I get up and the first thing I do is I get on my knees and I pray. And the way that I've always prayed with the help of my sponsor is that I get on my knees to remind myself which one of the two of us is God, because sometimes I get confused and I forget. And the second way that I pray is I say thank you. I don't say please, I say thank you. And the reason I say thank you is because of something Chuck C said in his speaker series, A New Pair of Glasses. And Chuck C said, how are you going to believe that you have something that you don't have? He said, there's a trick to it. You have to know that every precious gift has been given to you at the foundation of the earth, and that it is the Heavenly Father's great pleasure to give you his kingdom. So whatever it is I'm looking for, the reality is I'm already looking with. I get up in the morning and I thank God for every day of my life. I thank God for having directed, I put it in the past tense, having directed my thinking. How much time do I have left, Marcella, by the way? Just want to make sure I'm on a good path. I got 3 minutes? Okay, thank you. I thank God for having directed my thinking, my decisions, my intuitions for the day. For
what a day when necessary.
Okay, thank you, Richard. Having divorced them from self-pity, self-seeking motives, and for having made me a maximum service to God and to my fellow man. And that's how I pray in the morning. I go to a meeting at least on every single day, and I study. I study whatever is going to be in the big book or the topic for that meeting. And I'm lucky because I know what the topic is before everybody else does in the meeting that I host. I call my sponsor almost every day, but pretty much every day. I have two sponsees now who call me every day, and I make my every best effort to take their calls. And if I can't, I have my sponsor field their calls. He likes to make a joke that he can only be a pinch hitter once, and I have two sponsees, so that can make it difficult. And anytime something goes wrong throughout my day, and the way I know it's going wrong is because I'm having an emotional reaction to it, I call my sponsor immediately. The way it was at the beginning is I thought I could get away with 5 minutes, and that's enough time for this alcoholic to think that he's solved a problem that's only been buried under the rug. And the thing is, what I buried is a fuse, and that fuse is connected to TNT. And so whatever minor thing happened on Tuesday lights the fuse for the explosion that occurs on Thursday. And it took me like a solid year to recognize the cause and effect. And I called up Richard, my sponsor, one day, and I just said, I don't like having to spend twice the energy having to create the problem and clean up the wreckage of the problem. I'd rather just douse the fuse. So I'm going to call you immediately and douse the fuse. It's a much more efficient way to live. That's what it says in step 10. When we're no longer running the show, we become much more efficient. We're no longer in danger of excitement, fear, worry, or foolish decisions. I'm no longer burned up. That's the deal today. I relax and I take it easy. I ask God and my sponsor for guidance and direction. And as long as I don't mess up my own life, my life continues to go well. You know, my sponsor pointed something out to me the other day. He said, you know, Jay, on a continuous basis over the past 15 months, you've been serene and you've been peaceful. And there's even been happiness that's been a part of your life continuously. That's the longest I've ever been happy. I mean, I remember the first day I woke up and I was happy, and I looked around like there was something wrong. I didn't feel like I had anywhere to go or anything to do. And I always had somewhere to be, you know, I always had something to complete. And I wake up one morning and I'm happy. And I went, wow. You know, I've said a lot in meetings that I'm happy, and I had no idea what I was talking about. I didn't know what that could be like. And it says that in the 12 and 12, it says something new has been added. Something new has been added. And one of the promises of step 9 is that we'll get a new happiness and a new freedom. You know what my old happiness was and my old freedom was? I could do anything I wanted to whenever I wanted to do it, regardless of the consequences. Nobody could tell me what to do. I had a problem in Austin, Texas. I would go to Mexico. Like, that's just the way I solve problems. That was my happiness and that was my freedom. The other happiness and the other freedom was wrapped around a bottle of alcohol. If I want happiness and freedom, I know how to do that. I'll go to a bar and I'll drink. No more problems. It removes the problem. I don't need to solve a problem. I'll remove the problem. Too bad the next day I wake up and the problem is still there. So what I'd really like to communicate to everybody is the greatest gift that this program has done for me is there's been two really big controlled experiments in my life, and I'll just wrap up with those. The first one is I had donated everything that wouldn't fit in my car, and I was living in a national park. I wasn't talking to anybody except my parents on a sporadic basis. and I was still miserable. I was still miserable and I wasn't drinking. That's a great controlled experiment, guys. Nobody else, all the people, places, and things I thought were doing it to me weren't there. And I was still miserable and I wasn't drinking. So the problem is either me or God. Great controlled experiment. The second controlled experiment was this. When I met my current sponsor, I had the same job, the same car, the same family, the same apartment that I have today. Everything in my life is the same, except I have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. And it had nothing to do with alcohol because I already had 3 years not drinking. You know, I hear people who drink after not drinking for 15 years because they're not practicing the program of AA. And what I would like to communicate more strongly than anything else is that I needed a sponsor and I needed to go through the 12 steps of AA in order to recover. It was insufficient for me to just stop drinking on my own. And I invite you guys to do the same because it's a wonderful life and it's been that way for over 15 months now. Thank you, AA. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jay. Thanks a lot. So I'm posting in the chat email that is associated with, can you hear me? Yes? Okay. That is associated with.
You just cut off.
Okay. Okay, so can somebody help me to post in the chat the email associated with our seventh tradition? We also have a phone list. I'm not sure that we're, yeah, good, thank you. We have a phone list and also we have a WhatsApp chain where we stay connected during the day. And this recording will also be posted in, published in our YouTube channel. Do you have the link for the YouTube channel, Jay? Okay, so now our meeting is open for 3 minute shares. I don't see any hands raised, so I'll start talking myself. My name is Marcel, I'm an alcoholic, and I just have one sobriety date that I intend to keep today. It's October the 3rd, 2008. I'm just so delighted to see you guys again twice in one day. And I also feel it's like, it's all the advantages of being a newcomer that I'm feeling these days with none of the disadvantages of being a newcomer, because everything feels fresh and new and exciting and is the old message, but it feels it's the same, but it's different. And it's so exciting. My experience is different and the same. I also got a sponsor. I was lucky to be born in a group that is big book, big book, big book in coffee shops because we don't have parking lots in Boston. So it's coffee shops and the big book. And I met my sponsor in Boston and then she moved to Sydney, Australia. And now she lives in the UK. And I spoke to her this morning. And I just have so fun memories of her, you know, reading the big book with me. And I was telling her how excited I am about this group. And in these 12 years and a chunk, I've experienced three miracles. The first one, that I stopped drinking and I stopped drugging. The second one, and that I got like this incredible, the same thing, like this incredible certainty that my life was okay and that the world was okay. The second one, that I was able to transmit it to somebody else who was shaking, who was fearful, who was full of anxiety and full of fear. And the third one, that it continues to evolve and continues to grow and grow and grow, is that wherever I turn, I find a growing community where I feel welcome, included. I am appreciated and I'm useful and makes me feel safe and protected. I am not the kind of person that gets angry. I'm outwards, I'm the kind of person that gets depressed. And I haven't been depressed in almost 13 years because of AA. What no psychologist, no rabbi, no priest, no yoga guru could never give me, I continue to find in AA. Okay, guys, so if somebody raises their hand, Jeff?
Martel, yeah, hi, I'm Jeff. I'm an alcoholic. Jay, just I want to thank you for your share. And it has special meaning to me because I met you when I first moved to Dallas. And I also was fortunate enough to witness your development and know you how you were and know you how you've developed and who you are today. And it's I can say it's a you're a different person, and you've inspired me to walk the same path and do my best to develop the same way you have. And it's you said some great things, but to me the real example is your actions, and I see you practice that and demonstrate that every day in front of a lot of people, and you've helped a lot of people, including myself, along the way. So really appreciate your share, and I'm really glad you're here. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeff. So I guess I'm going to start calling on people whose faces I can see, beginning with Richard. Am I pronouncing your name correctly, Richard?
You are. I am Richard, grateful alcoholic, April 19 of 86. And I'm actually pissed off at you, Jay. The new and improved version of me is so much better. It's beyond me. And you're doing terrific. And I'm very grateful for that. And your father don't know this, but I have told him he's got three fathers, Jeff, you, and God. And I'm very proud to have you as a stepson. And today I was watching the last episode of Spartacus and on Starks. And at the end of the show is when he's dying. And the people are saying to him about how sad that he's dying. And he goes on to say, this is the greatest victory that I have ever had. I'm free. And when I heard that, I cry a little bit too, because I realized that I'm also free. And what I'm free from the vast majority of the time is from the negative pull of the world. And one of the things that I'm very grateful that I have become for the world rather than being of this world, because when I was of this world, I was the pits. By the way that you spoke is very good. Too bad you haven't got my accent. And it's even worse that I don't have your accent. So anyhow, I'm proud of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Tara?
Hey y'all, Tara alcoholic. Well, I'm glad I got to see Richard cry. Jay, thank you for sharing your story. I'm totally not gonna cry right after Richard. Oh man, you know, we all are getting to know one another through this AA gift from God. And your openness about where you came from and we all can see where you are now. And you are such a fine example. You know, we know you're not perfect, but we see you walking the path, and it inspires all of us. something that I related to a lot of the things that you said, but something that I really appreciate you including is how you finally got to a point where you had to basically just give up everything except for your full-time job in AA. And that's kind of where I've gotten to. I kept trying to pile on some things, and you know, I'm at 6 months and I was really feeling really serene until I started trying to pile on some things recently. And my ego didn't want to let go of them, but my peace and serenity and my sobriety needed me to. And so I just really appreciate you saying that, because I had been kind of bouncing around with that going, you know, am I just being, you know, I've been just like trimming the fat off, you know, and this is what my life is. It's this simple, beautiful thing where I'm working, I'm doing AA, I'm being a mom, and I've never been here. Thanks for being a part of that. I appreciate that. I really do. I'll pass.
Thank you, Tara. Let me see. Marty, would you like to share?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. My name's Marty. I'm an alcoholic. I am early in my recovery still. Today is the 117th day of a continuous abstinence from alcohol, and I would say it's probably the fourth or fifth week of continuous emotional sobriety that I've been able with the help of my sponsor to develop. What I can say is how similar to some of the things that have been mentioned. So my story is maybe a little bit darker in places than Jay's, but again, the reasons for that not being much worse are the people that I've been blessed to have around me. God has this way in my life of always sort of popping a person into my life who changes things and helps me. And whatever guided me here was pretty overwhelmingly graceful. After I stopped drinking, a few months ago, and I lost my sponsor to a relapse, my first sponsor at the time, and how lost I felt there. We talk about in this group experience strength and hope, and the hope is always that someone else gets it faster than you, right? And what's been amazing for me is one of the conversations we had when I first started really feeling happy, when I really started to understand I don't have to live like that anymore, I don't have to be that person anymore, I can start to be a better person, and I can be happy, I'm allowed to be happy now. When I first started experiencing that, and I think I mentioned something to Jay, like, holy smokes, I can't believe how bad I was feeling back there. That was terrible. And it had been only a couple days after losing my sponsor, where that kind of like pink cloud was gone, and I was feeling really lost and really miserable. And I also didn't have alcohol to, at least go to oblivion. And Jay was, laughing along with me and said, yeah, imagine doing that for 3 years. It's like, oh my God, that sounds terrible. And it was one of the hardest I think I've ever laughed in my entire life, and I still laugh thinking about it. But the amount of hope that gets generated by this group, and I see people understanding things faster than even I was, allowed to. So I'm so grateful to be a part of this, and I really found my home here. So thanks, everyone. And with that, I'll pass.
Thank you, Marty. Jeff? The other Jeff?
I am Jeff. I'm an alcoholic. Thank you to everybody in this meeting for allowing me to join your meeting. It's a wonderful meeting. And thank you, Jay, for your qualification. It was both inspiring and from the heart and very honest. I had a 40-year drinking career, and I have two sobriety dates, but not for the reasons that most people have more than one sobriety date. One sobriety date is June 21st, 2009, which is when I stopped drinking alcohol. And the other sobriety date is April 1st, 2019, which is when I finally got my pigheadedness hammered aside and actually started working the program. And during that 10-year period when I was dry, not drinking, but not working the program, it was amazing that I couldn't understand that my relationships with people and the way I was living my life weren't getting better. I was able to avoid a lot of the health hazards and side effects that you get from drinking. So I had, for one thing, that was really nice, no hangovers. Boy, were those bad when I was having those. But other than that, really wasn't doing much better, still having trouble with my daughters and with my family. And Jay at that point came to me and he said, you want to have a better relationship with members of your family. How's what you're doing working so far? And I said, well, it's not working real well. You're right. He said, well, what if you tried the program? I know you don't think it'll work. And I know you don't like the idea and you think you're too busy, but how about if you try it? And I took a deep breath and said, you know what? I was crazy enough to drink for 40 years and I finally stopped doing that. Maybe I should try this. And I went into the rooms and right away got a sponsor because I had no idea how to do the steps or what the program was really about. And it really changed everything. The program just shines a spotlight on so many realities that we face in our lives, on our character defects, on the way we're interacting with other people, on all the things I blame on everybody else that really are derivative of my own behavior. What a revelation, and such a hard thing to absorb if you don't work the steps of the program. So I'm really grateful for that. And that really changed my life. And for that, I really owe a lot of that to my family and to Jay in particular, who is my son and who I'm very proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you. You did something well raising that child. I don't see any other hands. So should I call Seth?
Hey everyone, my name's Seth and I'm an alcoholic. And man, that was freaking awesome. I'm glad that I practiced a similar program to that guy. That's a good shepherd to have. But one of the things that I'll comment on that I am most appreciative of Jay for is his ability to wipe the fog off the mirror for me. And he touched on this in depth during his share, but my biggest problem, I don't know, I had a lot of problems. One of my biggest problems was my complete inability to recognize my contribution to anything. And that's because from a very early age, I became adept at manipulation, blaming other people, and just being unwilling and unable to confront facts. And what Jay has taught me is that this, if someone condones and permits that in your life, that is not loving, that's enabling. And unfortunately, I'm not blaming anyone else. I did have a lot of enablers, but none more so than myself. And being able to have someone reach out their hand to help me by showing me what I was doing in a loving and gentle way. It's like having another parent, really. Only my parent turns out to be 10 years younger than me, bizarrely. I just really appreciate that. And honestly, you know, one of the things that is not lost on me at all is this idea of grace. And my entire life, I was just entirely blessed. You know, I had parents that did a lot for me that I love. I had a wife who stuck with me for fuck knows why for 10 years. Even when I was in the depths of my behavior, I have a group of good friends that hung around me for a long time, even though I behaved the way that I did for as long as I did. But one of the biggest things that is not lost on me is I came into this program in November of 2019. And within 5 days, I found my current sponsor and a person that could show me how to do this the right way from the onset. And more often than not, what I've seen is people struggle to find someone who can show them the way to work this program. And just another instance of how freaking lucky I am to not have to be mired and treading water and getting, you know, lost again and again, but having someone show me the right way from the get-go and not having to struggle. And also, you know, part of it is having a willingness to do it. But I know from my own personal experience that it took someone that could call me out on my stuff and show me the right way to do it for me to ever get this. Otherwise, I would have found a cop-out and an easier, softer way that invariably would not have yielded any results for me whatsoever. So Jay, I admire and appreciate you and thank you for all that you've done for me and my family, because without you, I wouldn't have the benefits of a daughter that wants to even be with me. I wouldn't have been able to cope with and deal with situations involving my family over the past year, even the loss of my dog, and I sure as shit wouldn't still be married. So thank you very much for all that you do and all the time that you dedicate to me in this program.
Thank you, Seth. We have time for one more, or we can close early. Okay, Rita.
Hi, everyone. Thank you. I'm Rita, and I'm a grateful Al-Anon. And the reason I'm a grateful Al-Anon is because someone named Jay encouraged me to go to an Al-Anon meeting after I tried and hated them and thought everyone was a loser. But I don't have the allergy, so I didn't feel I could be an AA, but I guess what you would call me is a dry drunk, because I just am messed up in the head and everywhere else, except I just didn't drink. But if I stopped drinking and didn't work the program, then but thanks to Jay, just spoke, and I really appreciate it. I've been in an Al-Anon program for 2.5 years, and I do attend an open AA meeting on a regular basis, and I'm, you know, learned the benefit of service, and I can really see a difference between how I was when I first came in and the way I am now. And the programs are similar, but hearing your shares and seeing Jay's growth and the way he was able to just really bring it for 12 steps and make sense and admit to so many things, it's very humbling. And I'm proud of everyone in this room and all of us who try so hard to make something, to make our lives more than selfish piles of crap. So anyway, thank you so much for all your service, Marcella and Richard and everyone here. Seth, nice to see you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rita. Well, it is time to close the meeting, and we are going to do so by observing a moment of silence, followed by prayer. Jay, would you be so kind to lead us in prayer?
All right, Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Keep coming back. It works, y'all.